Hey everybody, it's Fran in the office. A little change of pace from being over at the lab table, but you know, I did that video about the Franocaster last week, and in that video I explain not only about the guitar, but a little bit about some of the impedances that I've had in playing the guitar, mainly arthritis. And there are so many comments in the video about people, you know, talking about their own battles with arthritis, and tons of people recommending links to things and therapies and supplements and stuff. I really thought that I should do a video just about my path in dealing with arthritis, because, and I'm going to be pretty blunt about this, because there are going to be lots of people with their own recommendations, or I read this article, or I do this, or a person I know does this, and you need to do this, and you need to read this book about this, and see this guy's website, and buy this herb, and take this, and do that, yada yada. There's no end with arthritis to people recommending treatments and stuff that you should take or rub on your skin or things you should do. But I'm here to say I am an expert in arthritis, and I've spent you know, the last almost 15 years living with it, dealing with it, and attempting to extend my functional life even with the constantly degenerative nature of arthritis. And I've learned a lot about things that can be done, and I've definitely learned about what cannot be done. And I guess what I want to do in this video is to shine some light on arthritis, and also to put a very like cautionary note on people who want to buy into a lot of remedies for arthritis. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. Let me start by saying that the whole thing began for me probably when I was in my late 30s. It was probably like 5 years before I actually got diagnosed with arthritis. I was built, well, and maybe even 6 years before, but I was building my second loft in Brooklyn, one of many, many lofts that I built. I was building my second loft in Brooklyn, the new Frantone factory. At the time, I had to build several rooms. It took months, many months, for me to build the workspace. I had to build rooms, run in electrical, plumbing, yada yada. And I think when I got to the point where I was running electrical lines, I had to spend a better part of a week running electrical cabling and putting in outlets, hundreds of outlets. And so day after day, I was doing you know, work with pliers, you know, bending heavy gauge wire, like 12 and 14 gauge wire. It was all done with BX cable. I don't think they even make BX anymore, but, you know, lots of splices and joins and lots of outlets wire up. Anyway, very, very hard on the hands. And I think after like the second day of doing that, I woke up and I couldn't close my hands. They were like claws. And all the joints in my hands had sort of frozen up, and I had to run my hands under hot water to get them to flex. And that was the first indication of problems with my joints. But like I said, it was many years later, when I was about 40, I had, or 41 maybe, it's hard to remember, but I had a constant pain in my hip that wouldn't go away. And I went in to the doctor, had it looked at, because I thought I had maybe, you know, fractured something or hurt something somehow doing something, and got an examination, blood work, x-rays, and it came back. They told me that I had arthritis, but they said, you know, I shouldn't worry about it, yada yada. Well, you know, as the months went on and years went on, it was hips, knees, feet, hands, shoulders, neck, yeah, and it just kind of went from there, elbows, you know, wrists. And so, you know, in the early years, it was very difficult for me. I didn't really know, I was very hard on my body, and that's getting ahead of myself, but part of the process that I went through over years was, well, first you go to doctors, and doctors give you recommendations, But you have to take into consideration the doctors, especially general practitioners, and even specialists, when it comes to arthritis. The boilerplate recommendations, you know, they come from medical school, and they really haven't changed much. And those boilerplate recommendations for arthritis will say, well, you know, maybe you can take fish oil or collagen, you know, supplements, lift weights. Oh yeah, you gotta lift weights and, you know, stress those joints and, you know, hot soaks and lots of rest. And when you have stiffness, you gotta splint, you know, you gotta splint your fingers and everything and wear braces and all stuff. I mean, this is the standard recommendations. And it all comes from, you know, practices that were developed long ago and haven't changed much. And I found that this advice is wrong. It's all wrong. I explored all of the standard treatments, supplements, weightlifting, stuff like that, physical therapy, and I spent like a couple of years going to this place where they had a heated tub where I'd float for about an hour. And, you know, it was by the time I got in like the fourth year, I was miserable. I could barely move around. I was walking with a cane. The joint degradation continued and stiffness continued and the pain just kept going up. And I was really depressed and it seemed pretty hopeless. But I decided that everything that I was doing was wrong, and I decided to start from scratch, and I went and did my own research. And what I found is that in dealing with arthritis, there's really two camps. Well, I shouldn't even say arthritis. In dealing with joint injuries and joint destruction, there are two camps. There's the geriatric medicine camp of arthritis, which has its own sorts of treatments and ways of doing things, like and all the things that were recommended to me, the supplements, weightlifting, all these things, splinting, all that stuff, comes from geriatric medicine, dealing with advanced old age, rheumatism, autoimmune diseases, things like that. I had tested throughout the years, I've been repeatedly tested for all of the autoimmune diseases, lupus, rheumatism, Lyme disease, all these things. They every now and then get tested for all these factors, always come up negative. So the diagnosis for me was that it was osteoarthritis, although I started coming down with it in my 30s. And so there's no family history really of arthritis in my family. I went to lots of doctors, lots of tests over many, many years, and I had to pretty much decide with my new doctor that for me, diagnosing the root problem of the arthritis was difficult because it wasn't a matter of having a test that was going to positively tell me what I had. I really had to depend on all the known tests to tell me what I did not have. And so what was left was a series of possibilities, and I went to check them out individually, scientifically, and the only way that you were going to be able to understand the disease process when you're trying to figure out with a data set of one, just one individual, is you have to find ways to have controls. And the only way that, and this is part of the reason I'm making this video, the only way that you can know whether a single thing, whether it's something that you're taking or a medication, a supplement, or a treatment that you're doing, the only way that you can quantify whether that thing is actually making a difference or if you're just suffering from the placebo effect of just believing that you're better, or maybe some other combination of factors that have nothing to do with what you're actively trying to do, but something on the side changes, such as your diet or the weather or your environment, you know, allergic factors in the environment or whatever. Something else changes that is off to the side that makes a change to your condition that you would attribute to something that you're trying to do, like taking a supplement or a medication. But the only way that you can really quantify whether what you're doing is helping you or not is you have to have like a scientific control. And that means you really have to figure out everything that could possibly have an effect on your condition, such as environment, the weather, you know, what's the humidity like? Has it been raining a lot? Is it cold? Is it hot? You know, what's your general stress level? Not only physical stress, but psychological stress. What are the activities that you're doing? Are, you know, what joints are affecting you the most? How are you using them? When are you using them? You know, you have to itemize everything that you're doing physically, emotionally, medically, and you, in order to figure out if any one thing will help, you have to have very strict controls over everything, including your diet, calories, exercise, everything, and just change one thing in the list. A new kind of exercise, a new kind of supplement, a new kind of diet, a change of this, but just one thing, and you have to control all the others. And it takes years to figure out what changes actually make a difference positively, which things actually make a difference negatively, and over time, really quantify exactly what your treatment is. And that's what I did, and it took many, many years. And I found that the supplements, whether you're taking like collagen or fish oil, things like this, these things are pretty much useless, because unless you're arresting and actually stopping the disease process, you can take all the supplements in the world and your body's not going to apply them, because there's an underlying disease process that's preventing your body from really rejuvenating the cartilage to begin with. And until you actually address the underlying degenerative process, you're not going to have any restoration no matter what you eat. And so for me, I had to really figure out what was causing my joint destruction. And I had come up with an hypothesis based on the idea that, number one, because I don't have any family history and because I didn't have any factors for any kind of autoimmune disease, that a big factor for my own problem was that I had spent my adult life being very hard on my joints. I spent a lot of years doing hard labor, physical labor, and I had definitely worn down my body a lot in my younger years just because of just doing very high stress, high physical stress stuff. You know, the work that I was doing was very, you know, hard on my body. And apart from that, I suspected that there were hormonal reasons, because, you know, I'd been on estrogen for decades, and, you know, my doctor told me that, you know, I was really in uncharted territory, because there was no medical data on people that had been taking estrogen supplements for, you know, more than 20 years, and this was some time ago. My doctor, who was a specialist in, you know, this kind of endocrinology, said, "Look," she said, "you know, you're in uncharted waters." She said, "There's just no long-term studies done on people who, you know, who transition early in life and take estrogen for decades. There's just really no empirical evidence. So there's really nothing known about the long-term effects of taking, you know, estrogen as a supplement." You know, hormone replacement therapy for decades and decades. So I took the drastic step of ceasing to take all hormones. And I went through the most vicious menopause that you can imagine. It was just just stellar hot flashes every day, all the time, for years. Not like just like a few weeks or a few months, but years of them, and I still get them. But I spent a few years, with no hormones at all. I went through that huge endocrinological transition, and I wanted to start from scratch. And I as a result of doing that, I had a very measurable and dramatic drop in my inflammation over a period of like a year. And on top of that, I began to research joint recovery, because, like I said, there are these two camps with joint injuries. There's the geriatric medicine, which deals with rheumatism and arthritis, with the idea that it's an incurable condition, it's degenerative, it's progressive, and all of the research therapies and treatments go to dealing with pain and discomfort rather than trying to really deal with the actual core source of the joint destruction, trying to reverse it, because it's assumed that it's not reversible, not treatable. So I stopped looking into that camp and instead spent my time researching sports medicine, because sports medicine is the only area where joint injuries are actually researched empirically, like actually researched with the idea of trying to develop techniques and treatments that actually restore joint function and repair cartilage. And it was through researching the advances in sports medicine that I found that the treatments for arthritis, especially like the weightlifting, the splinting and stuff, that is absolutely not what you should do when you have joint destruction. That only makes it worse. I went to employing a regimen of constant motion without stress. And what that means is you want to stay active. Instead of splinting and remaining in bed and being inactive when you're having discomfort, you want to keep moving. You got to keep flexing the joints. Range of motion. Keep everything moving, you know, even if it hurts, but without stressing the joints, which is not weightlifting, not using like hand tools, very low impact aerobic movement, and keep moving all the time. And I developed this sort of radical change in lifestyle to keep myself moving all the time, going for long walks. I got to a point where I biked less and less, and these days I don't really use the bicycle at all anymore. I walk everywhere because the walking is much better. I'll get into that in a moment. But constant motion without stress is the best way to deal with like managing joint destruction. And can't emphasize this enough, diet. You've got to have the right diet. Fresh fruits and vegetables. You know, don't take shitloads of supplements, pills and fish oil and collagen and all this stuff. If you just eat fruits and vegetables and have a low-fat, high-protein, highly nutritious diet, low on processed foods, keep your calorie count low, and keep your body mass index low. This was another thing. Losing weight, I had gained a lot of weight during the arthritis years because, for the first like 5 years, I was getting more and more sedentary, and the medications and supplements and such that I was taking and the kinds of diet that I had, I gained a lot of weight. And so eliminating, getting that weight down and getting my body mass index down was a critical step in helping me to get my mobility back. You gotta keep your body weight down, and you can't eat crap, you know, this is the thing. I highly restrict my sugar intake every day. I highly restrict my carbohydrates every day. And I strive to maintain a constant body weight. You know, I get down to like 147, 148 pounds, and I know that's kind of where my body's ideal, and I weigh myself every day and I try to stay at that weight. And keeping your body mass index as low as possible is critical. If you can't do that, you're not going to be able to really deal with your arthritis. It's just going to make everything worse. If you can't control the diet and the calories, there's not going to be much hope of doing much else. But that being said, constant motion without stress. And this led to the third prong of my attack on arthritis, which was joint stress management. This is the other part I can't stress enough. This was what I kind of talked about in that guitar video, because stopping playing the guitar was part of my joint stress management. I keep a tally up here in my mind, not on paper, but in my mind, I keep a tally every day of the joints that I'm using, how I've used them, and how much stress I've applied to them. So if I'm doing things that are hard on my hands, I keep a tally of that, and I have to manage the hours I do that. And if I'm hard on my hands one day, I can't be hard on them the next day, particularly in the same way. I have to allow my body to recover, I have to allow inflammation to go down before I can, you know, put that level of stress on again. And so daily stressful routines had to be eliminated. And so there has to be this sort of randomness in joint stress. You know, I could do certain things, like if I have to do heavy lifting of things, you know, do a lot of stress on my large joints, I can do that in bursts, you know, but I can't be moving tables every day, you know. It's just because, again, that leads to cartilage destruction. So joint stress management is a huge part of dealing with arthritis. So, you know, again, nutrition and, you know, the right diet, you know, low calorie, high protein, fresh fruits and vegetables, you know, no soda, don't eat lots of sugar, processed foods, stuff like that. A good nutritious diet, forget the supplements and yada yada, you know, forget all that stuff. You know, constant motion without stress, so don't do the weightlifting and everything, and don't do the splinting, keep moving, you know. You know, you gotta keep that, you know, the joints moving, but with minimum impact. And then the third is the joint stress management, which has, you know, if you're having problems in certain joints, you have to be very aware of what you're doing that's causing the stress on those joints. So if you're having problems with your hips, you know, body weight becomes a huge stressor in that, you know, and, you know, when it's, you know, hips, knees, and ankles, and feet, body weight becomes a huge factor in that. So, and also getting the right kinds of exercise that you can do every day is part of that regimen of joint stress management. Now, like I said, I went to walking because this is the fourth part of it, is that in addition to having osteoarthritis, I also have osteopenia, which is the precursor to osteoporosis. And so, and this is another discussion I had with my doctor a lot, because there are two sharp edges to the sword that is osteoporosis and osteoarthritis, because the more you reduce joint stress by having low impact exercise, the more you exacerbate osteoporosis and bone loss, because in order to keep your bones, you have to have impact on your bones and your joints. You know, jumping up and down, like high impact on your bones, is what get your body to invest the calcium to keep those bones. So riding a bike is much better on the joints for exercise because it's completely low impact, but it's terrible for the bones because you don't have the impact for, you know, for to keep your bone density up. So I switched to walking. It's much harder on the joints, but walking maintains the bone density, you know, in the hips and femur and such, which I'm going to need because, it was a trade-off where it's, well, you got to figure out if you want to live with the arthritis or if you want to break your hip. And I realized that breaking a bone would be, you know, probably a life-ending thing. So it's a trade-off. And you have to find these trade-offs, you know. But what I can say is that through the process of joint stress management, constant motion without stress, good diet, and, you know, having a, you know, a very restricted diet. You know, I don't eat a lot of foods. I don't eat dairy anymore. Like I said, keep the sugar down. And this is the other part of it. This is the last part of it. And this is the part that I guess I should probably said at the beginning, because probably very few people watching it at this point. But the last part of dealing with arthritis is pain management. And I guess I should put a link in this thing. If you want to go right to pain management, go to this point. So pain management. So when I got to the, I guess it was like the fourth year that I was dealing with arthritis, that was the point where I was overweight, walking with a cane, spending that time in that heated tank. My doctor suggested to me, well, you might want to consider at this point pain management. And that sounds like a good thing. Pain management. Oh, relief. Finally. Whew. Now I can get on with my life. Well, pain management means going on morphine. And because you can't take Advil every day, you can't take Tylenol every day, you can't take acids or aspirin, you know, handfuls of them every day. You can't do that. I mean, the liver won't tolerate most painkillers taken at any kind of dosage for very long. You know, you kill your liver, And that's it. And so pain management means going on morphine. And once you get on the morphine, that's it. One-way trip, you know. And the idea of being 44 years old and going on morphine, I wasn't thinking about being functional at 60 or 70, because there's no such thing as a 60-year-old who's functional has been on morphine for 20 years. I mean, everyone knows about the opioid crisis. It is a one-way door that once you go through it, you don't ever come back out. And there's no other door on the other side except for, you know, death itself. I wasn't going to do that. And so, for me, pain management was about learning how to have a relationship with pain, learning how to live with pain. And it's contrary to our Western thinking about pain. And I read an article in the Times a couple weeks ago that was very poignant and on point about exactly my philosophy about it, which was that it has, you know, come about in American culture that pain is a disease, that it's something to be cured, that's something to be feared. And this is just isn't the case. I mean, you can learn to live with pain. And so it requires that you have a different relationship with pain and discomfort. You have to have a different relationship with your body. And you have to learn to unplug the fear of pain and discomfort and embrace it in a way. There's really no language to really explain it beyond the idea that I had to methodically go through the way that I looked at my body from the inside. And I had to stop looking at my body. It basically means that, you know, in the subconscious or in the background, you're always looking at things that are going on. If a pain happens, you're looking at it. Not with your eyes, you're looking at it with your brain map of your body. Because inside your brain is a body map. And they sort of discovered this using sensory deprivation tanks, but you can do it too. If you go into a meditative state, you can examine your own body map. You know, if you're lying in bed without covers on, and especially if you don't, you know, have like any impedance of like clothing or anything touching your body, if you can get like as neutral as possible with like with the sensations coming to your body. If you go into a very meditative state and look inward and just with your eyes closed in the dark, without using light or anything, just look at your body and imagine your body the way that it looks, just from what it feels like. And you'll feel that all of the parts of your body, and if you really want to have some fun, you can look up the sculptures that have been made of the body maps of humans based on scientific research, and these grotesque sculptures that have huge tongues and huge genitalia and big hands and you know, a big face and then these tiny little feet. It's based on the way that the internal body map of the body is carved, and this is what we're looking at when pain happens in the body. The mind is putting attention into the body map to where that problem is, and your attention is being drawn to it. And I had to find a way to disconnect that. I had to turn off the body map so that I could still be functional and dexterous and do all the things I have to do, but I had to cut the feedback, because you get this feedback loop. You have a sensation in a joint, a pain here, that causes the part of the brain to focus on that part of the body, and it causes this regenerative feedback loop that causes the attention to the pain to cause you to experience the pain on a certain level as discomfort, distracting, yada yada. And I had to find ways to cut off the pathways between my conscious mind and the subconscious and the lower brain parts of the brain that were controlling this feedback from sensations that were coming to my body. I had to stop looking at all these sensations. Now, I can still voluntarily look at my body. And there's times when I allow myself to do that. If I'm lying calm, and if I turn off all these filters that I've built up in my mind and allow myself to look at my body, the din rises and I can feel every joint and every nerve, and it's just this overwhelming cloud, and I just cut it off. And this is how I live. Now, if a pain develops that's above that normal threshold, that background, I'll be aware of it. And, you know, I'll probably change my behavior to deal with it. And I'll try to get it down to background again. And I wouldn't even call it pain tolerance, because it isn't that I don't no longer feel pain. But when a pain happens, I have the ability now, I have the skill set, and I've built the pathways and the changes in the brain and in my mind to unplug the fear component. If you can take the fear out of it, you can deal with a lot of pain. It breaks it down to information. And if you can cut off the emotional reaction to it, the part that says, be afraid, something's wrong, you're in danger, you have to do something about this right now. If you can cut off those emotional reactions and look at that intense data and say, that's very interesting data, and not be afraid of it, and say to yourself, there's nothing wrong, there's nothing to do about that, there's no emergency. I acknowledge that data. And so I haven't taken any painkillers for 10 years or so. Not an Advil, not an Excedrin, not an aspirin, no painkillers at all. For migraines, headaches, joint aches, everything, it's all coping. And I'm a living testament that it can be done. And you can live with an awful lot. And it doesn't have to be terrible. You just simply have to voluntarily and willfully change your mind. And anyone can do it. It can be done. You can manage the pain without meds, absolutely, 100%. You can manage the joint stiffness with constant motion without stress, 100%. You can, if you employ all these things, particularly if you keep your weight down, have the right nutrition, you can begin to reverse joint destruction and actually get some of your cartilage back. And I have regrown a significant amount of my cartilage, particularly in the larger joints, which I really feared. I didn't really get it back in the hands and the smaller joints where the cartilage was kind of thin to begin with, but in the larger load-bearing joints where there's the capacity to have thicker cartilage, I did have a surprising amount of regrowth and repair. And again, you have to keep your inflammatory factors down. If you can't get the underlying disease process under control, nothing else that you do will make any difference. You have to do everything you can to get the inflammation down, you know, eliminating allergens, having the right diet, environmental factors, stress factors, all these things. You got to get a handle on it, and you got to really control everything. For me it was a top-down lifestyle overhaul. How I did everything, you know, the tools I used, the work I did, everything had to change. It took total commitment. But here I am, you know, 15 years into it, still going. I intend to go another 15, 20 without meds and everything. Just, you know, deal with it. And so I know everyone's going to have advice. This was a very long video. I know everyone's going to have their advice, but, you know, like I said, forget all the hubbub, treatments, supplements, snake oil, all that stuff. Forget it. Follow my advice. Understand your disease process. Get your inflammation down. Get your weight down. Don't eat crap. Exercise every day. Constant motion without stress. Exercise every day. Manage your pain without meds. Do it up here. You've got it up here. The brain has everything you're going to need to deal with it. I did it. You can do it. And that's it about arthritis. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all the patrons on Patreon. You didn't pay for this one necessarily, but they make all these videos possible. So if you want to thank anyone for this video, you don't have to thank me. Thank the patrons on Patreon who actually finance this channel and make all of these videos possible, including this one, all about arthritis. So there you go. I'm Fran. I'll be back probably over there at the lab bench real soon. Bye! In the lab. That's where I work. In the lab. Go berserk. In my lab. That's where I work. At the bench again.